Hello everyone. Narcissist Free Almost here, and today is part 2 of Countertransference Reaction, Diagnosis and Management, according to Otto Kernberg. Last week I left off with comparing and contrasting of Mr. A and Mr. S, and the issues Kernberg attempts to resolve in regards to his countertransference reaction. Today, however, Kernberg will be talking more about understanding than managing countertransference reaction when working with severely pathological individuals. First, the problem, in the case of chronic countertransference reactions with patients presenting with severe psychopathology, is that its very slowly developing diffuse and invasive nature may infiltrate the entire psychoanalytic process, to the extent that it interferes with the immediate analysis, and may require consistent work outside as well as during the sessions, in order to understand it and then transform it into an interpretation. In other words, the psychopathic mode of projective identification is a slow and methodical process, so insidious that the analyst needs time, and probably outside help in interpreting their own countertransference reactions. And speaking from first-hand experience, having been married to someone who is the malignant narcissist Kernberg so often talks about, the reactions to projective identification are just as he describes. Someone who is normal, and would assume that the pathological is also normal, will experience this process internally as subtle confusion with a tinge of anxiety at first, then start to see the narcissist as shadowy, and the experience as somewhat unreal as you carry on with the as-if relationship. Of course, a normal empathetic person will attribute these feelings as something wrong within themselves, trying to figure out what they might be doing wrong. Tragically, these are the early warning signs that often go ignored. These reactions are your intuition telling you that there's something wrong. Lucia Tower, 1956, has suggested that some chronic countertransference reactions can be understood only retrospectively, that is, after the analyst has shifted to a different emotional position. From this viewpoint, the older assumption that preoccupation with a patient outside the sessions indicates some problem in the analyst needs to be modified. Such preoccupation may sometimes derive simply from lack of understanding, due to lack of experience, or the unusual difficulty of the case, but, most frequently, it derives from the development of chronic countertransference reactions in cases of severe psychopathology. So you can see here, an interesting symptom of becoming entangled with a narcissist is preoccupation with that person. And why would that be? Well, because like I said earlier, a normal healthy person thinks that the problem lies within themselves. And of course they would, since most people take personal responsibility for their own internal life and actions. This preoccupation could also be understood as a sort of curiosity mixed with anxiety as well as confusion. At first it would be like the saying, I just can't put my finger on it, leading to a dedication to finding out what's wrong with oneself. The anxiety will be because of a growing cognitive dissonance, and the confusion from the gaslighting. All of which slips past your awareness, because you assume the person you're with is a normal person like yourself, which couldn't be further from the truth. Kernberg has found chronic countertransference reactions to be particularly frequent in the treatment of patients with severe narcissistic personalities, patients with regressive sadomasochistic transferences, patients who express a very primitive type of hatred in unconscious efforts to destroy the very communication with the analyst, such as the syndrome that Wilfred Bion described in 1958, as including pseudo-stupidity, curiosity, and arrogance. Also patients with as-if characteristics and psychopathic transferences. Patients with severe paranoid regressions and transference psychosis may also bring about chronic countertransference reactions, as may patients whose acting out takes subjectively dangerous forms such as the risk of suicide, homicide, or active persecution of the analyst, for example, in the form of threats of lawsuits. In all these cases, very primitive internalized object relations, and sometimes truly psychotic nuclei, become dominant in the transference, and apparently defy the ordinary efforts of the analyst to resolve these regressions interpretively. In other words, these severe psychopathologies will definitely bring out the worst in you. So much so, the analyst will need to take extra measures to assure correct interpretation of not only the patient's transferences, but their own countertransference reactions as well. Finally, here's Dr. Kernberg with some things he'd like to add,
Thank you, Sally. Okay, so I would like to point to some particular aspects of countertransference management that are helpful under conditions of chronic countertransference development. In other words, how am I going to manage my own constant internal reactions to a deeply disturbed pathological patient? First, I have found it very useful to try to imagine how a normal patient would react to a normal analyst under the conditions in which an interpretation has been given, and then imagine the patient who is unable to accept or to understand the interpretation, or the patient that immediately incorporates this interpretation into a psychotic system, and lastly, the patient who distorts the interpretations in ways that interfere with further work. Second, what would a normal interaction between a patient, daring to depend on the psychoanalyst as a trustworthy person who is attempting to help the patient without being omniscient or omnipotent, and the analyst between an imagined potentially normal interaction with a patient, and the present transference-countertransference bind, will help clarify what is abnormal and strange in the context of, A, the patient's subjective experience, B, in his behavior and, C, in the countertransference itself, and how these three elements might be understood in their mutual relations.
In other words, the analyst would be constructing in their own mind the idea of what would be considered your normal, run-of-the-mill interaction between a normal analyst and normal patient. With that framework in mind, the analyst would then consider deviations from that interaction, for example, what that would look like with a psychotic patient, etc. Next, the analyst would consider all interactions, or the transference and countertransference together, using Kernberg's three-step formulation to manage chronic countertransference reactions. Again, this would be the patient's subjective experience, the patient's behavior, and lastly analyzing the countertransference itself, which is the emotional reaction of the analyst to the patient, as well as understanding how these three things relate to one another. With that said, for practical purposes, Kernberg's simple formulation could definitely help suss out a dangerous personality of someone we meet, or already know. Of course, most people will politely entertain someone else's subjective experience as fact, but these days, you have to be more careful, because as often as is the case, this might as well be fiction. Next, and I think this is more important, is being aware of someone's behavior. Does what they do and what they say match up? But also, pay close attention to body language. Often, someone with a severe pathology will have micro-expressions that might slip past our awareness, but leave us with the feeling that something is off, or not quite right. Heed this as a warning sign. Lastly, ask yourself, what are my internal reactions to this person? How do they leave me feeling? Do they seem phony? Overly friendly? Invasive? Etc. Again, if you're not in touch with your internal landscape, this will come across as your intuition, or that whisper in the ear that things are not adding up. If any of these things are the case, you would do well to err on the side of caution and let this person pass you by. And if all three are the case, my suggestion to you is, run for the hills. Well, that's it for this week, and if you found this content helpful, please give it a thumbs up, subscribe, and comment. You can find me on Facebook at NarcissistFreeAlmost, and on Instagram at Clumber_Lover. As always, sending you all my love and gratitude, and I do hope you're living peace of mind narcissist free. I know I am.